Hey, in this video, we're going to talk about encryption methods. My name is Shad Sluter, and I'm a professor at Grand Canyon University in computer science. So there are different types of cryptography that we've already looked at. We've looked at some of the ancient methods that date back even to Caesar. We've looked at modern methods using the AES algorithm, which has been in use since 2001. And in this video, we're going to talk about public and private keys using asymmetric cipher methods. I know that's a big mouthful, but it's super common. You need to understand it if you're working on the internet today. Also, in another video that's coming later, you'll see something about hash functions, especially with hashing passwords. And so these are all important topics for software developers and computer scientists. Now, let's talk about the difference between a regular way to do passwords and the public and private key. In the regular way, you just have a password that locks a document, and then you use that same password to unlock it. It's like a key for your house. The key can lock the document, the key can open the document. However, in private and public key, there's a completely different process that makes it work on the internet. So asymmetric means that there is a key that is used to open the lock, and there's another key used to close the lock. The public key can be used to encrypt the message. As a matter of fact, the public key is called public because you might even publish it on the internet. However, the private key is going to be private to you, and the only thing it can do is open the lock. So here we have a picture of Whitfield Diffie. It kind of looks like Dumbledore, if you ask me. But his invention in 1976, he created a paper called New Directions in Cryptography. He talked about the public and private key, and is really a brilliant idea. The most significant advancement in this science in the last 3,000 years. So incredible. So just as significant was a product that's called PGP, or known as Pretty Good Privacy. Anyone in the world can send encrypted communications now. And so Phil Zimmerman got into trouble with the government because the encryption is good. Nobody can break it. So there is the ongoing debate even to today about how good encryption should be. Should the government have a back door? Should they be able to look at your cell phone? Should they be able to read your emails? And the answer is pretty much coming up all the time is no. PGP is a system where you can communicate and nobody will be able to read your email unless they have the right password. So this applies to legitimate businesses and it applies to drug dealers and terrorists. Privacy is guaranteed. So how does it work? Well, as I mentioned earlier, symmetric encryption uses a single key for a secret document. So standard encryption, every lock is identical and the keys that go with it. So one password is all that you ever need. However, there are problems with symmetric encryption. Let's say you have a lock or a document. Let's kind of use those interchangeably. How do you trade with the person that wants to get into your lock? Well, you have to give them the key, don't you? So you could arrange to meet them in a gas station parking lot and hand the key over. That would be one way. But what if they live on the other side of the world? It's pretty difficult, isn't it? Well, for that solution, just send them an email, or maybe not. Because if you send something through the mail, it's obviously not secure. It could be lost, it could be stolen. And so a key in the mail is just as dangerous as sending a password through the mail. So we don't want to do that either. Also, another danger is that if you have a document and you give somebody a key and then you give another person a key and the third person, pretty soon you have duplicate keys and your lock is no longer secure. Everybody has a key. And so sharing a key with multiple people is just a bad idea. So the encryption for asymmetric processes is how we solve that problem. So here's how it works. Imagine a lock where not all the keys are the same. We have a red key for locking the lock, and we have a blue key for opening the lock. The red key is called the public key. The blue key is called the private key. So the public key can close the lock, or encryption in this case, and you share that key with your friends. As a matter of fact, you can share it on the internet. You can publish it online. However, you give one key, the decryption key, for yourself and your friends. They each have a unique private key as well. And so everyone has their own private key, and the encryption works. So let's take a look at some screenshots of the commands that you would use. So first of all, I'm looking at a terminal here for Linux or Ubuntu. So you type in GPG, and then you do a double hyphen gen key. So the gen key says we're going to create a public key. And you can see it goes through a few questions. So you generate two companion keys. So once you have generated a public key, you get this long string. It's obviously an encryption string. You can save this by publishing it online. You can send it by email. You can list it on a server system. Public keys are public as can be. There's no privacy about them. Okay, so let's say your friend wants to send you an encrypted message. So he gets your public key. Now he's going to import that public key into his software. So he says, I'm going to take this document, GPG, encrypt it, and I am going to put in the specific email address of the destination and then create an output file. So that's what the command at the prompt looks like. So then it generates an encrypted message. I have no idea how to read it. But then you can just copy and paste it into an email. So your friend attaches the text document or just copies it into there, and the public key cannot be used anymore. It's done. So now you've got the message. Your friend sends it to you. What do you do? Well, I take my GPG command, and I type in hyphen D for decrypt, and then I type the name of the encrypted file. And so then using the private key that's on your computer, and you know that password, it will be able to decrypt the document. So in another video, let's take a look at this process using an actual document, and it'll make more sense perhaps. Be sure to check out my channel. There's hundreds of videos about computer security and about applications and about computer programming. And I welcome you to learn along with me. Thanks for watching.